morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Department of Postgraduate Studies and Research in Psychology, I, Deepa Vanraj, welcome you all for the lecture by Dr. B.M. Hegde, former Vice Chancellor, Manipal University, Manipal. No occasion can begin without invoking the blessings of the Lord Almighty. May I request Ms. Harshita and Ms. Pragna to sing the invocation and seek the blessings of the Lord. Mental health needs a great deal of attention. It's the final taboo and it needs to be faced and dealt with. Quote unquote, Adam Ant. A sound mental health is an essential component of a good and healthy lifestyle. Understanding the need for a good mental health, October 10th is celebrated as World Mental Health Day. Diana Abbott once said, mental health is often missing from public health debates, even though it's critical to well-being. The Department of Postgraduate Studies and Research in Psychology aims to reach out to the public at large as much as possible. Therefore, the department celebrates October as the Mental Health Month and conducts various programs, activities scheduled throughout the month and does not confine to just one day. Today, we have with us Dr. B.M. Hegde, former Vice Chancellor, Manipal University, Manipal, to inaugurate the Mental Health Month. May I now request Dr. M.Y. Manjula, Dean of Postgraduate Studies, SCMC Ujre, to welcome the gathering.
Respected Professor B.M. Hegde, respected principal, dear colleagues and members of the audience, it's a proud privilege that I have of introducing Professor B.M. Hegde to all of you. Professor B.M. Hegde, I know, requires no introduction, but still it's mandatory I do it. Dr. B.M. Hegde is a physician par excellence, an astute clinician, and a teacher in the true guru tradition. Professor Hegde's encyclopedic knowledge, brilliant oratorical skills, and natural instinct to teach have endeared him to generations of students and teachers across the globe. Professor Hegde was born on 18th August 1938, had his early education at Hiriadka and Udupi, and later he went to Stanley Medical College, Madras, for his bachelor's course in medicine. Later, he shifted to Lucknow for his master's in medicine with Government of India scholarship. Subsequently, he went to England on Commonwealth Fellowship and had passed the membership of Royal College of Physicians of UK examination. He then underwent advanced training in cardiology at Harvard Medical School, Boston, under Nobel laureate Bernard Lohn, and at the National Heart and the Middlesex Hospital in London under late Walter Somerville and late Richard Emaniet. He is now a fellow of all Royal Colleges and the American College of Cardiology and the first Indian to receive this honor. Professor Hegde started his teaching career as a tutor in Manipal and rose up to become the Vice Chancellor of Manipal University. Dr. Hegde's academic brilliance has been recognized globally. He is Affiliate Professor of Human Health, University of Northern Colorado, former Professor of Cardiology, the Middlesex Hospital Medical School, University of London. He is also the Chairman, State Health Society's Expert Committee, Government of Bihar. He is a visiting professor to a number of universities in India and many countries around the globe. He is a recipient of numerous national and international awards. To name a few, Dr. B.C. Rai National Award for being an eminent medical teacher, Dr. J.C. Bose Award for Life Science Research, Pride of India Award from US, Distinguished Physician of India Award from API, Healer of Mankind Award from Symbiosis University, Pune, Vaidya Ratnakara Award from Shankaracharya of Swarnavalli Math, Karnataka Rajyotsava Award, among many others. Professor Hegde has been examiner for the MRCP UK, MRCPI Dublin examination. His monumental contribution to the art of bedside clinical examination, which is missing these days, regarding how to detect early splenic enlargement and how to assess the second heart sound with the stethoscope correctly, have been published in prestigious medical journals like The Lancet, The German Tribune, The Practitioner, and the JRCP over the years, and two of these have been cited in the American College of Physicians book on bedside diagnosis. Professor Hegde is a prolific writer, and his articles are frequently published in various magazines and newspaper, and his talk shows are sought after in the electronic media. He's a prolific writer who has penned nearly 35 books and over 3,000 articles in the lay press. During the last decade, he, along with 15 world-renowned scientists, some of them Nobel laureates, has been publishing a journal titled Journal of the Science of Healing Outcomes, of which he is the founder editor-in-chief. Late Professor Rustum Roy, considered to be the father of nanoscience, was Professor Hegde's mentor and had helped him to start the journal. He has also rendered his service to Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. In 2010, Professor B.M. Hegde was conferred the prestigious Padma Bhushana Award by the President of India. The latest honor that he has received is from Sri Venkateshwara Institute of Medical Sciences, honorary degree of Doctor of Philosophy in the year 2011. I can go on and on like this, as his achievements run into several pages. But to conclude, he is a physician par excellence, an original researcher, a medical philosopher, an able administrator, educator of lay public, preaches and practices minimum use of medicine with conviction, says that there is no pill for every ill, but there is ill for every pill. More than anything, he is a person who walks the talk. Sir, on behalf of the PG Department of Psychology and STM College, I extend a very warm welcome to you. I request our principal... I request our principal to extend a floral welcome to him. Our principal, Dr. B. Yashovarma, is a leader who has the vision and conviction that a dream can be achieved and constantly inspires us to dream big and guides us to tread the path of success. I welcome you, sir. I request Dr. Elizabeth Daniel to florally welcome our principal. I also extend a very warm welcome to all the faculty members of different STM institutions, students, and the public who have gathered here in large numbers to listen to words of wisdom from Dr. Hegde. Warm welcome is also for the members of the media who serve as a conduit between the professionals and the public. I welcome one and all for this exhilarating lecture by Professor B.M. Hegde. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Light symbolizes knowledge. Knowledge is an everlasting wealth. May I request the dignitaries to light the lamp and mark the beginning of this enriching session. Sir, we are delighted by your presence and are eagerly waiting to listen to you to enrich our knowledge by the pearls of your wisdom.
Can you hear me at the back? The last bench? Because I'm worried about the last benchers. You know, when I joined as a very junior teacher, I had an elderly dean. He is no more. May his soul rest in peace. He called me in his room and said, young man, look after two class of students in the class. The first benchers and the last benchers. The middle ones will look after themselves. And he was a very strict man. I had no courage to ask him why he said what he said. After about 5 years, he was retiring. A very nice man, very nice man. So in the farewell party, we were sitting and eating. So I asked him, sir, you had given me this advice. Why did you say that, sir? He said, look, the front benches are all muggers, rote learners, parrot repeaters. They will vomit the whole thing and get first rank and pass and become your colleagues. So better be on their best books. Because to have a junior colleague who is antagonistic is very dangerous. The back benches, they have not come here to study. You know, they are not worried. But they will become ministers very soon. And they'll be your bosses, so you better be on the guard with them also. So I'm always worried about the last benchers, because I know most last benchers that I have known, even in medical school when I was a student, are one of the biggest performers, the star performers today. Those who have built big hospitals, this Apollo. All my contemporary school, you know, it's sorry. Contemporaries in medical school, and they took very experienced doctors. They were. They took a long time to, you know, get into the profession. What's your name? Deepa. Deepa has not learnt her physics properly. She was saying we are expecting a brilliant talk, etc., etc. If she had learnt her physics properly, she would have known that sound goes very slow compared to light. Did you know that? Light moves very fast. That's why you see the thunder first, and then, of course, the lightning first, and then the shower. The same thing happens here. People look very bright before they talk, because the sound comes very fast. When the sound comes, you know what they are. So you don't have to worry about what Manjula and Deepa said. Now let us have a sort of a understanding between the two of us. I am supposed to speak for about an hour, Manjula. Yes, she says. And then you are supposed to speak after that. But we will understand that when I speak, you don't speak. And when you speak, I don't speak. Is that right? Oh, good. One more condition. I am supposed to speak to you for 1 hour. And you are supposed to listen to me. That's the second part is more difficult than the first part. If any one of you has finished his or her duty of listening to me before I seem to have finished my duty, all that you do is one hand up and I'll finish. Is that understood? Now don't speak between yourselves, because that will disturb my concentration. I must get the feedback from you, then only I can go on. And this talk is not structured talk that I have come here and I want to vomit the whole thing out. No. It can be 5 minutes, 50 minutes, 500 minutes, 5 days. Same talk. Okay? Agreed? Okay. Now, and once you agree, if you don't do follow that, I'll go to the court. Okay. Now, mental health day. Why a separate day for mental health? Heart health day, lung health day, Father's Day, Mother's Day. Do you know why this happens? We have not understood it. Each one of these days is a business venture. Now, for example, I'll give you an example. Heart Day. Was it recent? Heart Day was there. Where people are made to run. Who sponsors this run? The drug companies, the instrument companies, and hospitals. You think they are so good that they have come in philanthropic idea of helping people that they money fund it? No, no, no. It is a very good business investment. All of you, let us say now run from here to Dharmastra. Do you know what happens? Quite a few of you who don't have exercise tolerance will become breathless. You have exercise tolerance, supposing you have been running every day, nothing happens to you. Supposing you are running for the first time or running once a year for the heart day, you become breathless. The minute you become breathless, then your neighbor suggests breathlessness may be the early sign of heart disease. So there is already a bunting for heart day special checkup at concessional rate of 1,500 rupees. Now that 1,500 rupees is what you deposit. What happens? First thing they do is they take what is called an ECG. Have you heard of the ECG or the EKG as the Americans call it? You think, oh, this the doctor is very wise. He looks at it and says, oh, it's normal. You know, absolutely regular sinus rhythm. Both the doctor is wrong and you are also taken for a ride. Because this is only an artifact. Every human cell, how many cells are there in the body? Any biology students here? Anybody wants to answer, raise the hand. And no answer can be wrong. They are not nearly correct, but they can be, you know, they are not wrong. Every answer is a new thought. 10 cells, 15 cells? No? Millions? Billions? Trillions? Oh, good, 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 good. All of you are right. They have to be millions. They have to be trillions. Anyway, about 50 to 100 trillion cells are there in the human body. On the day you were born, how many cells were there? On the day you were made in the mother's womb? One cell. Good. Who's that girl? Good girl. Stand up. What is that cell called? Zygote. That girl, she must get the first rank. That little zygote is a fusion of the father's spermatozoon with the mother's ovum. And that cell is an individual. Did you know that? And that cell has a beautiful mind, brain. What is that called? Membrane. Not membrane, membrane. There is a brain in each cell. Each cell, there is a mind. Brain is not in the, mind is not in the head. It is in every cell. You had a mind on the day you were made in your mother's womb and you get a connection. Have you seen a television picture? Of course you have. Let us say you switch on the television. Lata Mangeshkar is singing. No, you are not seeing the singer. So let us say Hema Malini is dancing. Is Hema Malini in the box? Is Hema Malini in that box? No. What is in the box? Hema Malini energy waves transmitted from where she was dancing onto your screen by the switching on. So there is a energy which runs this world. Sister will call it as God. An atheist will call it as, you know, anybody can call it as anything. But I would like to tell you that energy runs this world. Very interesting. Now there are a lot of atheists here. They'll say, what is this chap talking? He doesn't know. Because psychologists in the West don't believe in God. But Indian psychologists do believe in God because years ago, the Indian Psychiatry Association passed a resolution saying that this godless psychology of the West, what is that? Freudian psychology. Have you heard of Freudian psychology? You haven't read my article, Freud was a fraud. Did you hear, read that? No. Go to the internet and read the article called Freud was a fraud. Oedipus complex. Have you heard of Oedipus complex? Oh, good, good. You're all postgraduates, so you must have read that. But you didn't know that Freud was a fraud, did you? No. Now anyway, that cannot be done. So they said, we will have the God wherever he is or wherever she is, whichever gender he or she is. And we will not bother him. You know, ritualistic religion is not scientific. But spiritual religion is scientific. So they said, we will have spirituality. You know what spirit is? Spirit. S-P-I-R-I-T. What is that? What is the meaning of the word spirit? Spirit. Spirits, you know, which is in the wine shop. Spirits minus S is called spirit. What is that? Yes. Red shirt. Spirit comes from spirus, Latin. Spirus is breath. So our ancestors, you think they were not wise like us, but they could observe one thing. They saw the animals running around, breathing. When they shoot them and they're dead, they stop breathing. So they hypothesized that breath is God, spirus, and then God enters you when you're born and leaves you when you're dead. So the word spirituality, connecting that to God, originated from the word spirit, which means breath. Today science, we know the breath, the breathing, which Ayurveda calls as prana, even naturopathy calls prana is yaka mele kelige hogta irthade hagagutade alla hindinide kelididre kashta kelthalva. Okay, the breath, the breathing. You know, there are a lot of rhythms in the human body. Circadian rhythm, ultradian rhythm, infradian rhythm, etc., etc. Of which, the biggest and the most dominant rhythm is breathing. And all the other rhythms automatically get subservient to breathing, which is called mode locking in physics. How many physics students? Physics, 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 no physics. Must read physics even if you want to be an artist, because physics understands this universe in a different way. Not the conventional physics you are taught in school, the real physics. What you are taught in school and college is the old, ancient, what is called particle physics. And our teachers don't want to change it because their notes which we have to be rewritten. That's the problem with them. Particle, conventional physics, solid physics died in 1925. When a student in the class in Zurich Polytechnic, 1925, a student in the class, like this girl who knew zygote, and who was the teacher? Albert Einstein, which according to your textbooks is the greatest brain in the world, he's a physicist, he's this, that. He's not a physicist, he was a clerk in the patent office. But anyway, he is being made as a god. You know, history is a very peculiar thing. What is history? History is what the historian writes. You want to sell somebody today, you can sell them as anybody. You want to decry the same person, you can decry with anybody you like. But it only requires who is writing the textbook. You must see Indian history. If you see the history, there is only one man in India, that is Jawaharlal Nehru. The history, present history. But if you write the real history, there is only one man who was against India, that was Jawaharlal Nehru. That is, you know, this is the two sides of it. Good lawyer like Jethmalani, you give him a biodata, he will prepare, he will present him in such a way that he should be given the path. But if you give the same thing and tell him, I want to win this case, he will picture him like a demon, he has to be sent to the gallows. Same data. That is why statistics is called, what's it called? Science without sense. There's a nice book. This is written by a professor of statistics in Washington State University. His name is Stephen Milloy. Stephen. S-T-E-V-E-N. not Stephen. You know, Stephen is also pronounced as Stephen, but it's Stephen Milloy, M-I-L-L-O-Y. And the book's name is Science Without Sense. It's published by Cato Institute, C-A-T-O Institute, Washington. If you write to them and say you are a department of psychology and you're a college, they'll send the book free. Because their Cato Institute is for good of mankind. They're not for making money. Very interesting, statistics. You can do anything with statistics, this way or that way. And there are various ways you can fool people in statistics and science. What is that? One is called Texas sharpshooters. You know what this means? You and I don't know how to shoot, so we're given a pistol and given a board. Shoot at the, there's a point where you have to shoot. And our hands are shaking, so we shoot all over the place. So what these statisticians do is, they go very close to that and see where a few shots have come together. They put a circle there and say, this is the target. I'll give you an example. There was a man called Ansel Case. Ansel Case was given $100,000 to study the relationship between fat and heart disease in various countries. So Ansel Case started studying. 22 countries he studied. Then put the XY graph, fat here, heart disease here. And the graphs are all over the place. So no relation at all. He can't present that to his bosses who have given him. This disturbs my concentration. Thank you. Can you hear me? So 22 countries, there was no match. And he couldn't give a negative report because the money people will say, oh, why did you waste our $100,000? So he started eliminating country by country by country by country, which did not fit. So ultimately, he had 6 countries left, where there was a seemingly a straight line. USA at the top, UK next, and then Canada third, then Australia fourth, and Japan at the bottom. So he said, heart disease is directly proportionate to fat. Very easy. One straight line. This is called fitting the data to suit your convenience. That's called Texas sharpshooting. The next one is called mixmaster technique. They call it as meta-analysis. You have some data from Purnima, you have some Manjula, some from Elizabeth, some from Yashovarma, and then the data is collected differently, the analysis is different, but they're on the same thing. And then you put them all together and then say, this is the ideal data from this meta-analysis. But what really happens is, it's like putting mangoes, bananas, sapotas and all in one basket, closing your eyes and putting your hand and taking one and saying, this is the representative fruit of this basket. The fourth one is more dangerous. That's called data dredging. Data dredging. You doctor the data after you get the data to suit your convenience. You sex up the data and publish it, showing that your study was the best study under the sun. So don't try any one of those tricks. Don't try statistics. Now come back to physics. What we were saying is, the physics tells you that the energy from this universal energy, the universal energy is now accepted in science as universal consciousness, which knows everything. And this is what we call God or, you know, whatever. Now this energy, when the zygote gets ready, connects the zygote to the universal consciousness. Then suddenly you appear on the television screen. You and I are television screen dancers. When the television is switched off, you are off. And the day you are born, the mind in your cell, which is called cell membrane, gets switched on because there is an antenna there, which is called, any biology students here? Integral membrane protein, IMP. The integral membrane protein has an antenna. So it connects to that and the cell gets energized. And the cell now knows all about this universe, posteriori and priori. Because it's a universal consciousness, a part of it, which is called individual consciousness. Which means me, Yashovarma, Manjula, Elizabeth,
We are all one. And no one can teach anyone anything he or she already does not know. But only thing is, you don't know that you know. You are in the dark. So what is a teacher? Teacher's job is to bring that out in you. That is why it is called education. In the olden days, education meant educe. E-D-U-C-E means deliver. Educe is delivering. How do you deliver? What does the midwife do? Stands by the side of a pregnant mother in pain, coaxing her, cajoling her, sympathizing with her, empathizing with her. But who delivers? The mother. But in the class, who delivers? The teacher. That is the wrong type of education. In the class also, the teacher's job is coax, cajole, sympathize, encourage, empathize with the student, and make the student learn. So a good student is one, a good teacher is one who makes the student want to learn. I jokingly say every teacher is a menu in the restaurant. You go to the restaurant, look at the menu, and the menu says chicken, gassi, or what is it? There's, you know, I was one day in a 5-star hotel in Bombay and seeing that Kori Aja Dina. He said, what is this? Kori Aja Dina. It says dry chicken made in the South Kerala way with the garnished with the coconut. Kori Aja Dina in Tulu, which became Kori Aja Dina, and some 500 rupees. So when you look at that, I'm a vegetarian, but otherwise I would have said, this must be very good, let me order that. So teacher must be so good that the student must say, I must learn this. And one day I must be like her. So the teacher should not all the time say, I know everything, you know nothing. There are a lot of teachers who say, hey, you are good, no good. Dadda ma. There's nobody called dadda. Everybody is equally brilliant, but the day you are made in the mother's womb, you get the same universal consciousness that comes to you. If there is a student who is badda, you are also badda. That's all the difference. But the difference is, you must be able to make him and convert him to a good student. That is your job. So that's besides the point. Now come back to our physics. So the universal consciousness is your mind, which is called individual consciousness. Now this is very interesting because in the year 1905, actually 1910, three physicists came to India to get wisdom. Charles Leadbeater, Babington, and Annie Besant. You all probably have heard of Annie Besant because she stayed on. She was made to stay on by the British East India Company to destroy India. But anyway, she stayed on according to our conventional history and became Annie Besant, who started the Congress Party with David Hume, and she did this and that. Anyway, that's not important. There were three physicists teaching physics in Cambridge University. They came here for enlightenment and they became yogis. They went to Himalayas, yogis, and then started doing meditation. When they entered their state of samadhi, Annie Besant describes in a book, it was like a microscope's third eye. I could visualize everything in this world and I could see the inside of atoms. So beautiful. What is inside the atom? She could see in her meditative state. And she has described it as, atom has nothing inside except it's like a cloud, an empty cloud. And she could see atoms from hydrogen to helium, 9 elements she has described. And she has written a beautiful book for you to read, which was published in Madras in the year 1920, called Occult Chemistry. Chemistry postgraduate students here? Occult Chemistry, that's the book. Annie Besant and Charles Leadbeater. Leadbeater. Now what happened to this book today? It has become a thick book, contributed by 7-8 chemistry Nobel laureates. But still, the original book is so good because you all studied in physics, in the conventional physics, that electron has got a central nucleus around which the nucleus has got a central nucleus, then around which it runs in atom and jumps from one to other and things like that. All this is bullshit. There's actually nothing there. And she beautifully writes, no physicist today knows, you know an atom, you know a subatomic particle, you come up to the leptoquarks, the leptons. Beyond that you don't know. And where did the lepton come from? But she writes there, The lowest particle seems like coming from another world, She calls it ethereal world. And it comes like smoke through a keyhole onto this atom. So beautiful. And this Ayurveda so beautifully describes. In Ayurveda, the mind has five levels. The child's mind is called manas. Do you know what manas is? It is compared to a dark room with a window. So you sit inside the dark room and you look out the window. Somebody passes that way. You smile at him. Someone else passes. Smile at him. A dog goes. Smile at that. A thunder comes. Smile at that. In short, a baby, do you know how many times it smiles? 500 to 1000 times a day. This baby is absolutely healthy. How many times do you smile a day? Once or twice maybe. That too, it may not be a natural smile, it may be a grin. But the less you smile, the more rigid you become, and the worst becomes your heart. The more you smile, the child's heart comes back. Child's heart is a peculiar heart. Where the child breathes in, the heart runs fast. Child breathes out, it runs slow, which is called sinus arrhythmia. But actually it is not an arrhythmia, it is arrhythmia. And this is a normal rhythm. Now as you grow up and stop smiling at everybody, start hating people, your rhythm becomes regular and regular and regular and regular. The day it is absolutely regular, you are dead. So now you know how to die easily. Don't smile at nobody and hate everybody. That is what Ayurveda says. Krodha, shokha, bhaya, ayasa, viruddhanna bojana, tapponalan, katva, amla, kshara, lavana, tikshnoshnati, rakta, pitta, prakopet. All diseases come like that. What's the treatment? Hita, mita, ahara, sevi. Samikshakari, work very hard. A lot of us don't want to work. We don't want to work, but we want to earn money. No, it says samikshakari. That's why Jesus said, sister will tell me, it is with the sweat of his brow that he shall eat bread on all days of his life. Right, sister? That's very good. So it's the same advice everywhere. Samikshakari. Then it says data. Data. Be a giver. Be a giver. Giver, one who gives. That's what Jesus said. He give. Pass it on. It is not for thee alone. Pass it on. Be a giver. Ishopanishad says, Tena, Tyaktena, Bunjita. Rejoice in giving. That's what Ayurveda says. If you want to be healthy, Data. Then Samaha. Treat everyone as equal. When you look at the principal, you say, Sir. And when you look at the peon, Hey. No. They are both human beings. The principal had more opportunity, so he is in the principal's chair. The peon had less opportunity, he is in the peon's chair. Otherwise, they are born alike, they will die alike, and they will live only differently. It's only in life. So don't make the difference if you want to be healthy. So he says Samaha. Then it says Satyapara. Don't tell a lie. Small, small lies you can say. When you don't want to pick up the phone, you can say he is in the bathroom. But don't tell a lie to harm others. To save somebody, you can tell a lie. But don't tell a lie to harm others. That's called Satyapara. Then what does it say? Then it says, Aptopasevi bhavet arogyam. Treat everyone as your near and dear ones. You must love the whole universe. That's called universal compassion. Love has three words in Greek language. That's the best language I have understood. In Greek, there are three kinds of love. The first one, the lowest base love, is called eros, erotic love. That is what you see in the cinema. Boy running after the girl in around a tree. And one, when she comes this side of the tree, she has red sari. When she goes that side, she has a green sari and things like that. So she runs. That's called eros. Then you have philosophy, philosophia. Phil is affinity. That's the second word in Greek. Affinity. You are very close. Philosophia. Love, wisdom. Sophia is wisdom. Phil is love. So philosophy is loving wisdom. But the last word is the most important. That's very important. That's called, really called, agapi. A-G-A-P-I. Agapi, agapo, means universal compassion. Which Shankara called as avinayam, vinayam. Vinaya. The real meaning of compassion is vinaya. Vinaya is not just saying, hello sir, like that. No. Vinaya is real compassion. Avinayam, apanayam, O Vishnu, he said. Shankara in his Shatpadi says. So the real meaning of compassion is agapi. I just want to be, you know, you love your child, love everyone like that. You love your mother, love everyone like that. So that is called aptopasevi bhavet arogyam. Then one it says, kshamavan. Sometimes you know you may say, I don't want to hurt anybody. Somebody might come and slap you on the face. What can you do? Now then don't be angry with him. Forgive him. Forgive him. That's called kshamavan. Kshamavan. Forgiveness requires a lot of courage. Supposing he hits you, nodibittennanu. I have got a gundal. Today it seems if you give 5,000 rupees, you get 10 gundas appearing on the spot and they'll kill anybody you like. So that is not courage, that is cowardice. But you say, okay, forgive him. He must have fought with his wife this morning and he wanted to take it out. Wife, you can't take it out, so he has taken it on you. So you say you forgive him. That's why I say, don't hate nobody, because good people love you. Bad people will give you an experience. Worst people will probably make you realize world is not very good and things like that. But nobody is bad. That's why the man said, there is so much good in the worst of us and so much bad in the best of us that none of us can criticize any of us. So everybody is good, everybody is good. And if you take it that way, life will be easier for you. So this is what the physics of life is all about. And this is what the physics of life tells you where the mind is. So that is the mind of a child called manas. You understand that? Child loves everybody. Now you send the child to school. Alexis Carrel, a Nobel laureate, wrote a book called Man the Unknown, in which there is a sentence. He says, beautifully he says, see, now we all think that going to school is the best thing, isn't it? Anybody has any doubt? Going to school is the best thing. But you know what Alexis Carrel says? Every newborn child is a genius. I'm quoting. This girl said, quote, unquote, not at the end. You say, quote, then say that. And then say unquote, full stop. Okay, next time. Now, what do you say? It's very interesting. Every newborn child is a genius, only to be converted into an idiot in school. Put on those fans because that boy is feeling very warm. He's fanning himself. Switch on those fans. Some of the fans are not running. It's very warm for him. He's very uncomfortable there. Every child, newborn child is a genius, only to be converted into an idiot in school. This is true. Rabindranath Tagore went to school. First class. Very difficult. Second class, he failed. So he came and told his father, who was a very intelligent man, a lawyer and a very rich man. He could do anything. He could even ask Yashovarma to give him a seat in STM college. He didn't do that. The boy comes and says, Dad, I don't want to go to school. Do you know what his father said? Okay, if you don't want to go to school, don't go to school. He didn't go to school. Rabindranath Tagore did not go to school. Did you get that? Right. But how did he get a Nobel Prize in 1913? He wrote in Bengali a poem called Geetanjali. It was so good that people said, see, if you had gone to school and studied English, this you could have written it in English and it would have been a great thing. He said, to learn English, do I have to go to school? He taught himself English in 2 years. And 1911, he wrote the Geetanjali de novo in English. And this poem came out, nobody recognized, because who knows Rabindranath Tagore somewhere in Bengal, world was only England, the British Empire. But one English poet, he was an Irishman, William Bentinck Yeats, Y-E-A-T-S, not Keats, there are 100 years difference. Yeats was reading this poem. And Yeats had got a Nobel Prize that year, that was 1911, for English poetry. And Yeats read this and said, my God, look at this poem. It's about 100 times better than mine. And I have got Nobel Prize and nobody knows this man. So those days there was no email, no phone. So he wrote a letter to Tagore saying that, Mr. Tagore, please give this poem to me. I will write a foreword for that and publish it in England. Tagore said, do what you like. So 1912, Yeats publishes Tagore's Geetanjali in England. 1913, Tagore gets the Nobel Prize for English literature, English poetry. A man who did not go to school gets the prize for English poetry. Can you believe that? So, you send the child to school. Manas of the child now gets fed with ideas. See, this is called buddhi. Second level of mind is called buddhi. What is buddhi? This is cow, that is dog, this is man, that is this thing. The child so far thought everything is same, loved everyone. So now, buddhi is past experience which is taught in school. That's okay. Even there, the child probably smiles at the dog and the cat and the tiger and man also. Then you get into another stage, which is called chitta. You read something, you know. A lot of people read a lot. Morning till evening they read, but nothing gets in. They keep on reading and say, I've read this book, I've read that book. And this ideas come in, and then you get yourself, aham, me. That aham concept comes in, me concept. And that is a level of chitta. So, manas, buddhi, chitta. At the chitta level, you get yourself into it. Now, in the manas, BMHD is passing there, child smiles. It goes to school and the teacher has said, anybody who is a mundu and a shirt, he is a man. So, it says, BMHD smiles. Doesn't matter. But when it comes, aham comes, I don't like that rascal. You see, this is the problem. The problem for mankind starts at the level of chitta. That is why Patanjali said, chitta vritti nirodha yogaha. So if you can make the mind tranquil, you become a yogi. Yoga is not kusti that you see on the television. No, no, no. Yoga is simply trying to make your mind universally compassionate and mind tranquil without vritti, vritti or undulations. And you must always try to stop that. That is called yoga stage. There is another shastra called Viveka. Some of you might have heard about Viveka Chudamani. If you read Viveka Chudamani, it tells you that you don't have to worry about anybody. You can always say, okay, I don't like BMHegde. So what? Let him be BMHegde. Let him do what he likes. I will do what I like. Why should I worry about BMHegde? That's one level. But in Indian concept, the mind of a child in Ayurveda, you can go one step further up, where the level is called Purusha. So now the first level is Manas, second level is Buddhi, third level is Chitta, fourth level is Purusha. At Purusha level, you say, okay, BMHegde is going there, I don't like him, but I don't want to talk to him, let him go to hell. That's Purusha level. You're okay, you're better than the Chitta level. But if you really want to be happy, you have to go another step of mind, which is called Ishwara. Ishwara doesn't mean God. Ishwara in Sanskrit means one who is one with all the things. One who can treat triumph and disaster just the same. And at that level, you are called Ishwara. So the five levels of mind described in Ayurveda are so beautiful, which tells you how you can, by real training, become at any level of the mind. So even if you go to school, you don't necessarily have to be an idiot. If you have Viveka. So elevate your mind. It's a beautiful concept which you don't have in the Western say mind only. Jokingly, some old man asked, where is the mind? The other man said, never mind. And someone said, what is matter? No matter. Now, today we know where the mind is. Mind is in every cell of every organ. Recently, one of my friends, Magdi Yaqub, did a heart transplant. He removed the heart of a young boy who had an accident and put it to a patient who was dying of a heart failure. Man recovered. Of course, it's not as easy as that. A lot of drugs you have to take every day. He recovered. But one thing happened. This man was a vegan before the operation. He was a vegan. You know, doesn't even eat eggs. Doesn't even look at milk. But after the operation, he wanted only chicken nuggets. Every day, morning, evening, he was asking for chicken nuggets. Then everybody was surprised. How did this happen? Then they went back to find out from the donors, this young boy who died, his parents' house they went and found out, he says, this boy was only eating chicken nuggets. So that idea is transplanted here. The mind of the child has come here. And then, you know, then only you know that every organ is a mind. You can have, let us say, your hand is cut off in an accident, God forbid. You lose the hand. But sometimes that pain of the hand which was crushed under the car is there, it impresses the area of the brain where this hand is represented. Now the hand is cut off, but still at times when the patient is worried, he gets pain in that hand which is not there, which is called phantom pain or a phantom limb. All this is because you have a representation in your mind everywhere. So this is about the mind in the Western concept, mind in the Eastern concept. Now what is this psychology? What is philosophy? These are all areas you got to think very seriously about today. Now, all this, if you forget, we don't have a science of man today in the Western conceptual science. Alexis Carroll, in the same book, another book which is called The Science of Human Possibilities, writes one sentence: there is no science of man. Because the conventional reductionist science, you can't have a science. In the biology that you and I studied in school, and the medicine that I studied in medical school, we were taught that the human body is like a machine with parts. Car machine, for example, carburetor, transmitter, gear, engine, etc., etc. No, it's not like that. Now, latest physicists have shown biophoton camera. Every cell in your body, every atom in your body emits a photon light. But you and I can't see that. Photon light cannot be seen with the naked eye. But a physicist in Germany in 1996 produced a camera called the biophoton camera, which can catch the photons. His name is Fritz Albert Popp. Popp has this camera, and if you can photograph a man, I can see the whole body's energy pattern. Very interestingly, Popp did an experiment. He just applied an ointment in the hand and rubbed it. Naturally, of course, the cells there get affected. Supposing you have pain, you rub an ointment. They show in the television somebody has a pain and the husband rubs that no pain or no on or something. Immediately she gets relieved. It's all 100% wrong. But anyway, now some cells get affected. But what he saw was the cells in the brain changed, which means we are one, so beautifully connected. And where the energy transmits at a rate of 1,86,000 miles per second. Supposing I give you a medicine, any medicine I give, it travels at 1 centimeter per second. That means you take the medicine, it has to go to the stomach, then it's go to the intestine, get absorbed, and then do, maybe day after tomorrow it will start working. But of course, many of you get relief immediately. This is known now. That's called the placebo effect. Before the tablet goes to the mouth, you are better. Because this recent study, very recent study showed, it is only the placebo effect that does any good to human beings. Every drug damages, but the placebo effect does good. For example, they did a study in Cambridge, which was done in Cambridge, Oxford, Hamburg, and Munich. 4 universities together did this study. They were running morphia drip for cancer pain. Morphia is the most powerful painkiller known to mankind. And then told the patient, this is not morphia, this is a new vitamin we have found, which prevents cancer recurrence. And would you believe 96% of the patients did not get pain relief when morphia was running in their vein. Then they crossed over the patient to the other side and ran saline drip. And what did they do? They told the patient, this is a new salt of morphia, which is so effective that your pain will go. 90% pain went. Then they said, this must be some hocus pocus. So they wanted to know what happens. So they did what is called fMRI, functional MRI of the brain. And when they told the patient, this is not morphia, the brain was sleeping. When they told the patient, this is morphia and what was going in was salt, and the brain, anterior portion of the brain, the forebrain it is called, secreted so much opioids, pain-killing opioids, that the man's pain was relieved. So they wanted to triple check it. What they did? They injected these patients with naloxone. Naloxone is a drug which will block the forebrain from functioning. So then they repeated the experiment. Nothing happened either way. Even if you tell him it is morphia, and give him morphia, nothing happens. No pain relief. Because the forebrain doesn't work. So the study very clearly showed for the first time, published 2 years ago, in a very prestigious journal called Science Translational Medicine. It's called STM. And the first author's name is Professor Bingel, B-I-N-G-E-L. Of course, for the study, they produced pain in a different way, very severe pain. They didn't study the cancer patients. They studied pain produced in the feet by some very bad method. Bingel, Science Translational Medicine. The title of the heading is The Placebo Effect. Placebo in Latin, I please. When once you are pleased, you get better. So, whether it's homeopathy, umapathy, ayurveda, ayurveda, naturopathy, etc., etc., the effect is placebo effect. The only difference is in modern medicine, we will do some harm because every drug harms. This was again done in a recent study using a most modern chip, which studies the mitochondrion in the cell. It's called MIT chip, mitochondrial chip. And using that chip, a scientist, a geneticist in Louisiana University, his name is Douglas C. Wallace. Wallace, W-A-L-L-A-C-E, Douglas C, D-C. And the study's name is Mitochondria as Qi. You know Qi, C-H-I? In Chinese language, it means energy. Mitochondria as Qi, C-H-I. And the journal is Genetics. Year is 2008. Volume is 727. No, volume is 179. And page is 727. Read this. It's a huge article. It requires about 10 times reading because it's full of physics. And what he did was, he gave a chemical drug. And this drug, when it enters the body, because it's a reductionist molecule, the body says, oh, this is not mine. I have not seen this before. So it must be poison. So it throws it into the liver for destroying. When it goes to the liver gets damaged partially. And if the liver cannot destroy it completely, a little comes out, which is called the first pass effect. Have you heard of this word? Pharmacology. First pass effect is what remains after being destroyed in the liver. But you put an Ayurvedic drug or a Tibetan medicine or a herbal drug, what happens? The body says, aha, yes, I know, this is food. My ancestors are using this. So it's food. So it doesn't send it to the liver. So if there is anything good happening, it happens only in the herbal medicines. All the bad things happening happen with chemical medicines. Even herbal medicines are converted into chemicals by us. Now for example, garlic. Garlic is a fascinating medicine. And people want to sell garlic as garlic pearls. Because a lot of sophisticated people don't like to eat garlic. It smells, it seems. I don't know how it smells. Garlic is a good smell, it's not a bad smell. So it smells, so the companies, they remove the SH group in the garlic and sell it as garlic pill. Now what happens? It is no longer garlic. The body doesn't recognize the garlic. So it goes out and goes out. Nothing happens. There are 43 studies on the effect of garlic pill on human health, and the study's conclusion is garlic is good for cooking but not for health. But they studied not garlic but garlic pill. But if you take garlic, it has wonderful effect in the human system. So see the difference? This is how the MIT chip study showed that we don't do much. It's the mind that does it. So mind is in every cell. Supposing you have a disease here, the mind recognizes it. But look at the chemicals which we give. You have, let us say, you are going for an exam today. Early morning you get up, some red ant or something bites you. So your mother is worried, it's all red there. She will go to a doctor like me, so I'll give immediately one antihistamine. Immediately I have given an antihistamine. You give, the itching is gone, mother is happy, daughter is happy. Daughter goes to the exam, sits there. By then the same antihistamine has gone to the brain, where histamine is a food for the brain cells. So that is blocked there. So brain cell doesn't get food. So this girl is asked questions. How many legs the cow has? She forgets, because how many legs the cow has, because her brain doesn't get any food. So she doses off in the exam and she says 5 legs and fails the exam. See the difference? Now this is called the adverse drug reaction, otherwise called ADR. And a recent audit showed the biggest killer of mankind today in the world is ADR. You didn't know that the modern medical establishment is the leading cause of death? Did you know that? No? You write down this. Death by medicine. It's a nice article. You must all read. Because, you know, psychologists, psychiatrists must read this, because every psychiatric drug that we give, from the first drug called Largactyl, chlorpromazine, came from rocket fuel extraction. And how do we make it a drug? That's a big story. I can't be telling in 1 hour. It requires about 10 hours to tell you how this whole drug king came about. So from Largactyl to the SSRIs, they're all very bad. So this is how modern medical drugs are damaging the system. And the death by medicine you wrote? The first author's name is Gary Null, G-A-R-Y-N-U-L-L. This journal is not available, but this is free on the internet. You go to Google and say, death by medicine, Gary Null et al., and you get it. Or if you don't want, you don't get it there, there's an article you write down. Is US medicine the best in the world? That's the article's name. Is US medicine, US is American medicine, the best in the world? The author's name is Barbara, B-A-R-B-A-R-A, Barbara Starfield, S-T-A-R-F-I-E-L-D, Starfield. ಏನಮ್ಮ ಬಹಳ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ಟೋರಿ ಉಂಟಾ ಆಚೆ ಅವಳಿಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ? ದಟ್ ಗರ್ಲ್ ವೆರಿ ಸೀರಿಯಸ್, ಈವನ್ ನೌ ಶಿ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಸೀರಿಯಸ್ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಟು ದ ಅದರ್ ಗರ್ಲ್. ದ ಅದರ್ ಗರ್ಲ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಸೀರಿಯಸ್ಲಿ ಲಿಸ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಅವರ್. ಹಾಂ, ನೀನು ಈಗ ನೋಡಿದ್ಯಲ್ಲ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಏನು ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಜೆಲಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಇನ್ ವೈ ಯು ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಎ ನೈಸ್ ಜೋಕ್ ದೇರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಎಂಜಾಯಿಂಗ್ ಇಟ್, ಓನ್ಲಿ ಯು ಆರ್ ಎಂಜಾಯಿಂಗ್ ಇಟ್. ದಟ್ಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಡ್. ಹಾಂ, ಶಿ ಹಸ್ ನೌ ಸ್ಯಾಟ್ ಅಪ್ ರೈಟ್. She was, you know, relaxed in the chair like that, listening to the other girl, talking to her. I've been watching them for the last 5 minutes. Come back to what we were saying. Starfield. The journal is JAMA. J-A-M-A. Journal of the American Medical Association. Year is 2004. And it's 284. Sorry, 284. And the page is 483. This is freely available. You get it on the internet and read that. Very interesting. Doctors went on strike in different countries where there are no private doctors over the last 25 years. Saskatchewan in Canada, Los Angeles County, Bogota in Colombia, and in St. Stephen's Hospital in Dublin, and recently in Israel. And when doctors went on strike, death rate fell down precipitously. Morbidity was not seen at all. And who suffered most? The morticians, because their coffins were not sold. So in Israel recently, the morticians gave money to the government to pay the doctors more pay so that they come back to work. And when doctors came back to work, mortality and morbidity jumped back to its original level. I'm not joking, I'm seriously telling you. In the British Medical Journal, you read this editorial, doctors going on strike will improve society's health. Now coming back to what I was saying, that it is all in the mind. Now don't you try to treat this mind very, very easily. No. You can't treat this mind by giving drugs. You have to be a well-trained mind yourself. And you have to be able to match that mind's frequency and try to shrink it. It's a head shrinkers. So you make them all right. And I'm sure a good clinical psychologist, can treat 99% of the psychological illnesses, barring the violent ones like, you know, maniacs. There you talk to them, they'll kill you or they'll kill the other person. So they require some taming. That is why you require some chemicals once in a blue moon. But other chemicals destroy you completely. So you become a zombie. And today you see a lot of this diagnosis of Alzheimer's, which was never there in the past. Alzheimer's is much less in India as compared to the West. And Alzheimer's is so common in the West because by the age of 30 in America, every human being is on two chemical drugs at least. At least two chemical drugs. Recently, a psychiatrist, professor of psychiatry, Leon Eisenberg, who was dying at the age of 89, so he called the press reporters and said, "You must tell the world that I've been the biggest criminal. I was a subservient to a chemical company, drug company, which manufactured a drug called Ritalin. And they didn't know what to use the drug for. So they gave me a lot of money. They built a house for me. They gave me a car. And they've been maintaining me till today. And all that I did was, I, being the chairman of the American Psychiatric Diagnosis Committee, there's a committee, I created a disease called ADHD. Attention Deficit, hyperactive disease. And he said, I created that disease. There isn't any disease called ADHD. And I was the one who said Ritalin should be given to everyone. And millions of American children have been on Ritalin. And thousands have died. Now at least I must have a clear conscience because the next minute I am dying. So I will... Can you believe that? You create a disease to sell a drug. This is called the modern science. So that is why now we have changed that science into a new science called science of holism, which I call as the new science of man. If any one of you is interested, There's a TED talk of mine on the internet. You go to Google and say B.M. Hegde, New Science of Man. It's called TED talk. And you get that. It's 18 minutes only. They permit you 18 minutes. But my book on the New Science of Man has come out. The new science simply says, health is not absence of disease. Health is enthusiasm to work. Enthusiasm to work. And enthusiasm to be compassionate. Our friend Freud had written years ago, health is work and sex. That fellow sex, everything revolving around sex. No. Health is enthusiasm to work. Morning you get up and ask yourself, do I want to go to college today? If the answer is yes, you are healthy. Don't have to go to a doctor. Then second thing is, do I have to be compassionate to somebody? If the answer is no, you better see either Elizabeth or Manjula. If you say, yes, I have to be compassionate, you're very healthy, don't see nobody. So Ayurveda also says the same thing. When you are healthy, don't go to the doctor. How do you know you are healthy? Ayurveda says, samadoshaha, samagnischa, samadathu, malakriha, prasannatma indriya manaha swastha ithya vidyate. You get up in the morning, you shit well, eat well, drink well, sleep well, and you don't hate nobody, you are healthy. The most important thing is, don't hate nobody. Read my article called Grudgeitis. You know Grudgeitis? Appendicitis you heard of. Tonsillitis you heard of. Grudgeitis. You hate somebody and that is the grudge you carry. And hatred is the biggest load on your back. Don't you ever carry hatred. Because life is too short. There's no time for hatred. And life is so short, you are in a transit lounge of an airport. The previous plane has brought you. You are there and next plane will take you. God knows when. You don't know. And you are not certain of anything because the normal physics, now I come back to what I said and left it at the middle, 1925, there was a student sitting in the Zurich Polytechnic. His name was Werner Heisenberg and the teacher was Albert Einstein. And the student told the teacher, sir, you are talking through your hat. What will happen to a student who tells the professor that he is talking through his hat? And who is the professor? Nobel laureate. You know, get Nobel Prize, you can talk anything. It's agreed. You can say anything, it's accepted. And who was the student? Werner Heisenberg. And what did he proclaim in 1925? The uncertainty principle. Said PQ is not equivalent to QP, which means if you observe an electron, you can either say where it is or say how it is moving, but not both at the same time. So fascinating. See, this is written in the Upanishad. Asino vrajati duram, shayano jati sarvata. Same principle, uncertainty principle. An Irish couplet says it so beautifully. I eat when I'm hungry. I drink when I'm thirsty. If heavens don't fall down, I'll certainly live till I die. Absolutely true. 100% true. Which means in this world, there are only two things which are certain. One is birth, which is certain. Other, death. Nobody knows when he's going to die. But people will have to die. In the little book called Doctor's Dilemma, Bernard Shaw, a fascinating dramatist, writes, don't try to live for here ever. You will never succeed. If you think you are going to be immortal here, no. But there is a method of becoming immortal. He writes, to become immortal, do something worth writing about or write something worth reading. Then you become immortal. How do we know Bernard Shaw is dead and gone long back? He wrote something worth reading. Or you do something worth writing about. By both ways you become immortal. But your physical body, that Hema Malini dancing there, the energy that you got on the day you are made, when the switch off, Hema Malini is gone. She is not in the box. You and I are in the box, television box. And as long as the switch is not off, we are dancing, doing all kinds of things. Harming others and hating others and creating a war. Cheating others. We cheat. Left, right and center we cheat people. All that in the fond hope that you will live here forever and take everything with you. See, Alexander when he died, he made four important declarations. A, his dead body must be carried by doctors. Why? Because in the even great Alexander could not be saved by the doctors. So they are useless fellows. So they let them carry the dead body. Then he said all the germs must be strewn on the path to the crematorium. People said, why? Because people should know all this I carried by killing so many people, destroying so many countries, and I couldn't take it, so I'll throw it away. Third very important thing is, he wanted his coffin to have two holes through which his hands could be put out. And people thought he is mad. No, he said, no, please tell the world that even the great Alexander went there with empty hands. And the last one is, he said, all those who are my ministers and others should go in front. Why? Because they were the ones who never advised me not to do what I did. What happens to kings is, a king who is surrounded by only sycophants. Supposing Yashovarma is the principal and he has a coterie of people who say, whatever he does, yes sir, you are right sir, you are right sir. He will never be a good principal. Somebody must tell him, you are wrong sir, because you know we are all fallible. Somewhere we make a mistake. And when somebody says, you are wrong sir, and he is proved right, he must be credited for that. Now Alexander, nobody said, told him, you are wrong. Because nobody dare say that. If you say that, your head will be cut off. So that the such kingdoms will not last. So the real mind is a tranquil mind. And this tranquil mind comes not by any external force, but by internal understanding of the whole. So my dear friends, all human ills, did I say all? Including common cold, originates in the human mind. There is nothing called a mind and a body. Today we know E is equal to M, which is in physics, it's called A duality. There's no difference. Physics says matter does not exist, it's only energy. So E is equal to M. And this was discovered by a Nobel laureate, double Nobel laureate, called Hans Peter Dürer. And Hans has written an article for you to read, which is called, you can read in the internet, matter is not made out of matter. Matter is not made out of matter. And that is what he calls as a duality. But he himself admits in that article that I have understood it only from the Indian concept of Advaita. A German, a Christian, writes that I learned this aspect of physics from the Indian Advaita, where sat, tat, this and that are same. And he quotes in his lectures, you can see in the internet, he quotes the Upanishadic saying that what energy is and matter is. He says, Bahir antascha bhutanam. It is inside and outside of everything. Charam acharamevacha. Energy is all the vibration. You are a vibration, I am a vibration, but we all look solid. That is what's called Maya. Charam acharamevacha. It's moving but looks non-mobile. Then sukshmavate tavijnayam. It is so subtle that nobody can see. And so beautiful. Nobody has seen an electron to date. You can't see an electron. How do I see you? Because a few photons in your body hit my retina, then I recognize you. But if one photon leaves an electron and hits you, the electron changes to something else. So you can't see an electron. But still you say, oh, if I don't see, it doesn't exist. Have you seen God? You have not seen God. So God doesn't exist. Have you been able to measure something? No? Then it's not science. Because Marie Curie said, science is measurement, measurement is science. Right? Have you got a thought? Did you have a thought when you came here that you must go here? It's not scientific. So don't think in future. It's not scientific. That's why the present Western science teaches us not to think. That's why they want to stuff only known stuff into your head and nothing moves. Karl Popper, one of the greatest thinkers of our time, in the 50s, he reigned the London School of Economics as a professor of science philosophy for 20 years. Karl wrote a book, beautiful book, in which says, knowledge advances not by repeating known things, but by refuting false dogmas. So there are a lot of dogmas in the field of science, and if you refute them and demolish them, you take knowledge forwards. So the new knowledge is, human mind is human body is human mind, human body is an illusion of the human mind, and diseases are not in the body, but in the mind. I'll tell you, for common cold, study was done on common cold. Common cold was 10 times more common in people who have frustration, some social frustration. So this is how it is very important, because common cold viruses are there in your nose and my nose every day. When your immune system guard goes down, it catches you. And the immune system guard goes down when the mind has got all these problems. Krodha, anger. Anger and danger are one word apart. one letter apart, D. You D add D to anger, it becomes danger. So it's very close to each other, and frustration is very, very bad. So you must have contentment. Contentment is not wanting more, but needing less. That's all. Contentment is very simple. Supposing I have one shirt, I should be happy I have one shirt at least. If I look down, there are a lot of people without a shirt. But if I look up and say, okay, so and so has got 100 shirts, yes, I am unhappy. So if you want to be happy, you just look down and don't look up. And if you look down, my young friends here, you are in the microscopic minority in this world. Not even 1% of people can reach this institution. Today, there are 67 million children suffering from a very major disease which medicine does not realize. It's called NIDS, not AIDS, NIDS. Nutritional Immune Deficiency Syndrome. And thousands of them die every month in India. We don't have money to feed them, but we have money to send somebody to the moon. Going to the moon is reductionist science, and it doesn't reach the moon. And even if you reach the moon, you can't get anything there. And you can't for another several hundred years live in the moon, because there is no atmosphere there. But why do we go to the moon? Because going to the moon is $100,000, which means the scientists get a lot of money, they build big buildings, the politicians suck up half of the money, then the babus suck up another money. So they want this grant giving, CV thickening, paper writing science. A study showed in India, 97% of the papers in science published in the prestigious journals are either fraud or useless. You don't understand that? And we say, every paper must be, you must write a paper. Now everybody must be a PhD these days. Without PhD, you won't get an assistant professor. And I interview professors' jobs and assistant professors' jobs in many universities. I sit there. The other day, we needed 6 PhDs for an assistant professor's post. 93 people applied. 93. And we sat there for days on end and could get only 2 people, because only 2 knew something about what they were supposed to teach. I asked a PhD candidate, I said, you're a PhD? Yes. Everybody is a PhD now. PhD is sold like, every university has got PhDs. And somebody said, 200 PhD students and all. And what is this? It's like selling idlis. So I told him, what do you write for PhD? Thesis, sir. I said, what is thesis? Thesis, sir. Thesis, you write knowledge and write. I said, okay, all right. But what is the meaning of the word thesis? Doesn't know. He has got a PhD, he has come for an assistant professor's post in a prestigious IIT, and he doesn't know what thesis is. Now this is our education today. Simply mug up. If you ask him a formula, he'll write it. But if you ask him what is thesis, he doesn't know. Isn't that interesting? Any students, what is the meaning of the word thesis? Anybody who answers what is thesis, the principal will give you a special dinner in one of the best restaurants in Beltangadi. He has agreed way before we came here. No? No. Very interesting. In the good old days, there were no Mangalore University, Mysore University, Harvard University. There were king. And the king had a court where if you have discovered something, you write about that discovery and go to the king's court and place it under the king's big table, which is called hypothesis. And the table is called, there's a pedestal called thesis. Now if the king accepts it and the assembly accepts it, you bring it up and put it on the table. That means you got your PhD degree. That is called thesis. Did you understand that? This is very interesting. You know, we don't understand to study. A recent study in Harvard University wrote learning, that what you and I do. Have you studied anatomy? There are so many branches for the facial artery. So for that, you can't remember the branches. So you learn a mnemonics. Sister Lucy's powdered face attracts many a temporary idiot. Then every first letter is one artery. This is how we learn. No, we must understand the subject. And when you understand the subject, it will never leave you. Rote learning will leave you within a few weeks, if not a month or two. That is why we are all very bright just on the time of the examination. And when the results come, you are back to the square one. Agida, hechaitalva, sorry. Beda, Allah, gantesh taitavla. On the gantai. ಒಂದು ಗಡ್ಡೆ ಆಯ್ತು ಮಕ್ಕಳೇ, ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳ್ಬೋದು. ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗೆ ಉತ್ತರ ಗ್ಯಾರಂಟಿ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ ಕೇಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ತೊಂದರೆ ಇಲ್ಲ. ನೋ ಆನ್ಸರ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಗ್ಯಾರಂಟೀಡ್, ಬಟ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ಸ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಆಸ್ಕ್, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಸಾಕ್ರೆಟಿಸ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ಡೂ ದಟ್. ಐ ಆಮ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಹಿಯರ್ ಆರ್ಡೈನ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಗಾಡ್ ಟು ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ಸ್, ನಾಟ್ ಟು ಗಿವ್ ದ ಆನ್ಸರ್ಸ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಹಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್ ಸಮ್ ಯಂಗ್ಸ್ಟರ್ಸ್ ಟು ಎ ಕಾರ್ನರ್ ಅಂಡರ್ ದ ಟ್ರೀ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ಸ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಇಫ್ ಒನ್ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ ಆನ್ಸರ್ಸ್, ದೆನ್ ಹಿ ಕಂಟಿನ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮೇ ಬಿ ಫಾರ್ ಡೇಸ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್, ನಾಟ್ ಇವನ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಫಾರ್ ಫುಡ್, ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸಿಂಗ್. ಬಟ್ ಸಂಬಡಿ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಆನ್ಸರ್, ನೋಬಡಿ ಆನ್ಸರ್ಸ್, ಹಿ ಗೋಸ್ ಅವೇ. And whenever somebody answers, if the answer is very bright like that zygote girl, he will say, you will be a genius. One day there was a boy on the under the tree. His name was Theaetetus. Theaetetus answered something very bright. And then Socrates said, you are going to be a mathematical genius. And after Ramanujam, the only mathematical genius in the world is Theaetetus. There's a book on Theaetetus, you read that. So beautiful. Which only shows how you can spot that spark in people. And the teacher's job is to light that spark, polish it. You know, have you heard this? You know, there's a nice saying in the Upanishad. Dagdam, dagdam, punarapi punaha, kanchanam, kantavarnam. You give your gold to the goldsmith. Dagdam, dagdam, he hits it, beats it, heats it, beats it, heats it, beats it. Kanchanam, kantavarnam, gold becomes shiny. So, heat it, beat it, and get the best out of you, and give you a shining. May God bless all of you. Manjana Swami bless all of you. And let us have a nice thing. I think it's a good department of psychology, because I know two of them are brilliant people. This girl, Elizabeth, I know from the day she was a very young girl who joined us in the Kasturba Medical College. And this Manjula, I am told by the principal, is a very bright girl. I'm seeing her only today, but she... You can try to understand people very quickly if you know how to understand these people. You get that smell, you know. This is the person who is chemistry. So thank you very much. No questions means two things. No questions means two things. The lecture has been so bad that it went above your head, under your head, by the side, but not into the head. The other thing is that you are so lazy that you didn't bother to, you are not here nearly mentally, but you are here only physically. That disproves physics, because matter is energy. Thank you. Professor has not asked a question. Ask.
I'm an eternal student, sir.
Huh?
I'm an eternal student.
Very good. That is the definition of a teacher. Teacher is a student till he or she dies. And you will never get Alzheimer's, because if you see one way of preventing Alzheimer's is keep your mental faculty sharp all the time. Learn something new. You know, people have learned, you learn Chinese, you will become 10 years younger. You learn anything new. Yes, ma'am.
Sir, this is regarding... Are you mentioning that mind is in every cell of every human being? And you gave us the example of a person who went in for a heart transplant. I said, sir, this is my question. There are people who undergo blood transfusion quite a few times. What happens to their personality?
Very good question. Very good question. Yes, very good question.
And the second one also I'll ask.
Yeah, so carry on. Ask.
The other one is, India, they say, is the... diabetes capital. Now they're also saying that it's becoming the thyroid capital. And what in our lifestyle is making us develop these two things? Could
very
you please
good,
clarify
very good,
for
very
all
good,
of us?
Very good, very good, very
Thank
good, very
you.
Good. Beautiful questions. You know, these are $1 million questions. The questions really provoke a very good answer. The first question. Yes, you're right. Even if you get blood transfusion, there are certain things that you can transfer from the donor to the giver. Because every cell has a mind. Now, I'll give you a reference for where every cell has a mind. This is, the whole work is done by a professor of cell biology. His name is Bruce Lipton. Bruce, B-R-U-C, Lipton T, same Lipton. And the book's name is Biology of Belief. Madam. This girl is so considerate. What did he say? Bruce Lipton. And the book's name is Biology of Belief. Biology of Belief. Bruce, very interesting. Bruce did another study which refers to students. Bruce was teaching. He was in the Wisconsin Medical School, but he wanted some money because an American professor is not paid very much. And he had a wife who was so bad that she left him. And he had no children, but still he needed some money. So he wanted some money. He moved to West Indies to a new medical college with a higher pay. There he found the students were not the mugging lot that you get in the American schools. And they were not very good students. So what he said was, he looked at the students and said, we will do a change in this class. We will not give the prizes to students who get the highest mark. But each good student, so-called, quote-unquote, good student, gets 5 students who are not good in the class attached to him or her. If all those 5 students pass the exam, you will get a gold medal. I thought this was a brilliant thing. He did an experiment. And do you know what he found? 100% of the students passed the exam. And not only that, he took these students to Wisconsin Medical College and matched them with the Wisconsin students and found these students are brighter than the mainland Wisconsin Medical College students. I mean, this fellow was his life is very interesting because he was doing everything. He even tried to be a film actor. He tried to be a dramatist. He tried to be everything, not successful. Ultimately, when he wrote this book, he had enlightenment. Up until he saw, he was studying a cell under the electron microscope. And it's so interesting that the cell in a live media, it was transforming itself every hour, every day. This fellow did not go out of the room for 5 days, even for food. He got some sandwich there and he was pissing there and shitting there only, never went out. Watching the cell. And when one day he saw the cell getting energized suddenly. You know, when the cell gets that antenna and they're energized, he was lost. He was an atheist. He did not believe in anything called God, anything called superhuman. He thought everything happens in science. 2 + 2 = 4. He never understood Werner Heisenberg. Because for 30 long years, Werner Heisenberg was condemned. If you tell your professor you are wrong, what will happen to you? You become an outstanding student. You know, becomes out. And he was an outstanding physicist for 30 years, till this ass called Einstein died in 1955. And 1956, Werner Heisenberg gets the gold medal, the Nobel Prize, the only Nobel Prize in physics which is given to truth. All other Nobel Prizes have been proved wrong. So, Werner Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, this Bruce did not know. Because in a medical college, we don't learn science, we learn simply some statistics. Medical science in modern medicine is statistical science, it's not science. Now, coming back to our Manjula's question, that day he got energized. And then he said, oh my God, there's something. And today he has become a preacher. Bruce Lipton goes around the world preaching people. And this book is a beautiful book called Biology of Belief. Now, to give credence to that book, there was this young girl in the NIH. You know NIH? Have you heard of NIH? You heard? Yes, ma. Spectacle girl who said like this. Because in India, this doesn't mean, what does it mean? I don't know. Yes or no? You said, Helama. Beautiful. See, that girl is good. NIH is National Institute of Health, which is one of those highest bodies of rubbish reductionist research in America. And it was headed by a man called Saul Snyder. Saul Snyder was a great man in the conventional sense of the word. Yarma? Saul Snyder was an arrogant man and his aim was to get the Nobel Prize. He had a postdoc, a girl, young girl, called Candace Pert. Candace, C-A-N-D-A-C-E, Pert, P-E-R-T. Candace was asked to do some work on some receptors in a cell. So she was doing working day and night, and then, but she was given about $100,000. She spent all that but didn't get this, what is called the receptor outside the brain, the neuroreceptors outside the brain. Till then we thought brain was the only mind. So Candace had almost come to a level where she was about to get it. Then Snyder calls her and says, Candace, stop the work, I have no money. You take something else and go with some other professor and work. But Candace said, sir, I'm almost there. I'm in Ujre. Dharmasala is just a couple of miles away. He says, I couldn't care less. Don't worry. But what does this girl do? She borrowed some money from her friends and she worked somewhere else. But at night, she continued to do the work that she was doing on the receptors. Middle of the night, she will go to the laboratory, open the room and keep doing. And then one day, she found the neuroreceptors outside the brain. She was so excited. She wrote up all that, but she was so tired, she wanted to have a holiday. So she locked her room and went on a holiday. You know, this good news or bad news spreads in the universities like wildfire. Somebody said, Candace must have got something, that's why she has gone on a holiday, blah, 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 blah. So Saul Snyder, because if you find out neuroreceptors outside the brain, it will be earth-shaking discovery. You will get a Nobel Prize. So this fellow got the room opened when she was not there. You know, a criminal act. And stole her journal. And studied that. And quietly wrote a paper. And sent it for publication and a copy to the Nobel Committee. So, see, before the Nobel Prize, you get what's called a Lasker Award, which is given for science highest award. So, committee already announced Lasker Award in the name of Saul Snyder on the work which this girl had done. And she found out when she came back, her book was stolen, made a big fuss about it, and nobody said, we don't know, somebody broke into your room, there was a robbery here, and somebody stole everything, etc., etc. And she was terribly upset. When she saw the Lasker Award, she said, aha, this rascal must have done something. So she went with her old ledger copy to the Nobel Committee in Sweden and showed them, this is my work and this fellow has stolen it. So the result was, of course, Saul Snyder did not get the Nobel Prize. Saul Snyder's Lasker Award was taken back. But Candace Pert, of course, didn't get anything and lost her job because she had opposed the boss. If you oppose the boss, you lose your job. So Candace started writing books and she wrote a book for you. Molecules of Emotion. The book's name is Molecules of Emotion. Molecules of Emotion. Her name is Candace Pert. And I think it is Random House Publication. It's a very good book. And Candace has written so many other books. But this is a very good, important book. There is one sentence I want all of you to remember. She says, time has come for us when we get a headache not to go for a painkiller, but to sit in one place, meditate, and get your mind in a state of tranquility when neurohormones, opioids get secreted from the forebrain and your headache disappears. Fascinating. There's a future is for psychotherapy and not for chemotherapy. Even cancer cells could be taught not to grow, but to love other cells. If you have strong mind, cancer simply dies. Cancer simply dies. Cancer is your own cell. A cell which has lost its control, that's all. It's a rogue cell which moves around aimlessly all over the body, settles somewhere and kills you. But if it's your own cell, you love the cell and tell the cell, don't harm me. You know, you are my friend. You don't know how, as I said, you know, Manjula's question, side answer. When a person gets a heart attack and doesn't die, 60% die instantaneously. If he doesn't die and doesn't have much pain and doesn't see a doctor, he will be normal within 1 week. Because what is heart attack? In one area, the cells die. Okay, that's called cell death. First stage of heart attack is cell death. When the cells die, the neighboring cells say, oh my God, my friend has died. What do I do? They slip and go to that place and fill the place. This is called stage 2 cell slipping. Understand? When the cell slips, The cell is held by a cement, which we call as collagen in Latin. You will confuse the students, collagen. It is just a cement which holds the cell. It is called the fibroblast, the mother of the holding cell. So the fibroblast says, where is my son gone? And this mother knows for sure that her son would not have gone anywhere except to help somebody. See how sure the body cells are? If your son has gone out, you are not sure where he has gone. But the fibroblast, the mother of the fiber, knows my fiber son has gone to help somebody. So what does it do? Fibroblastic proliferation. It produces more fiber and then enough fiber to fill the gap. Now the cells in the periphery, they can't slip out and come. They say, what do we do? So they hypertrophy, they become stronger. So four things happen: cell death, cell slipping, fibroblastic proliferation, and hypertrophy. By the end of that, is in weeks time, the heart becomes so strong again and the scar is stronger than the heart's original muscle. We used to dissect hearts of dead people. My boss was a Nobel laureate and he used to get these hearts. I used to see this 7-8 scars of heart attacks. People dying at the age of 104, 110, 120, Polynesian Islanders. Lucky they didn't see a doctor. The minute they come to see me, a heart attack patient will have fast pulse because he's worried. He says, heart attack means death. So what do? I want to slow his pulse. So I give him a beta blocker. It doesn't come down, I'll give him an ACE inhibitor. Doesn't come out, I'll give an ARB. What does this do? It knocks off our friend, the autonomic nervous system. Which is our friend in emergency. Autonomic nervous system came in evolution when God in his wisdom thought, we were hunter-gatherers in the forest. If a tiger comes to attack you, it doesn't eat the whole of you in one day because it's no hunger. So it might eat your hand and go away. God didn't want you to die. So he gave an autonomic nervous system where immediately bleeding stops, there's clotting occurs, blood redistribution occurs, your brain gets blood supply, you're not unconscious, you walk away from danger and next day you may survive, but the tiger will come to see an empty place there. Now this is knocked off by modern medical drugs. So if the patient survives in spite of doctors, he is a lucky man. But he doesn't get a strong scar. He will get an aneurysm afterwards. He'll get a ventricular septal defect. It has to be operated. So it's all a good business for us. Today, there is a study which shows American hospital owners want surgeons to do more mistake. Because more mistake means patient comes back again. You do more surgery, collect more money. So it's very nice. So that is how. Did I answer your first question right now? Was there a second question? What's the second question? Very good. This is called disease mongering. Write down. This is called disease mongering. You as psychologists must know, if I frighten you, all your secretions come up. When I frighten you, supposing you are in a room, I just suddenly jump and pop like that, you get, a jerk. And at that time, you secrete a lot of adrenaline. When you secrete adrenaline, what happens? Your chemistry students here, adrenaline first goes to the liver because it's a hormone of emergency. So it wants you more strength at that time because when you see a tiger, you want to run away. So adrenaline comes out, it goes to the liver, and in the liver there are gunny bags of sugar which are called glycogen. That is the mother of glucose. So it goes to the liver and releases glucose, which is called neoglucogenesis. All Latin, simply means nothing. Neo is new, gluco is glucose, genesis is birth. So new glucose is born. So all that you have to do is, you put a bunting. 1 in 4 Bangaloreans are diabetics. Are you one? This is what the bunting says when you get out of Bangalore airport. So supposing you are sitting in a car and looking at that, my God, 1 in 4. Maybe one. Adrenaline started secreting. You go to the laboratory and give your blood. Lo and behold, your blood sugar has gone up. And when once the report comes, you are labeled a diabetic for the rest of your life. So 50% of the diabetics are frightened lot. What do they do? Diabetic survey of Dharmasala village. So everybody comes worried. Enna blood sugar evlo irukku. And what happens? Blood sugar goes up. So everybody becomes a diabetic. Now you know the statistics. This is called epidemiologists produce epidemics. There's a nice article in the Lancet. epidemiologists produce epidemics. Number one. Number two, 10 million people in India take drugs to lower their cholesterol. Who on earth told doctors cholesterol is a disease? Cholesterol is produced in your own body by your own liver. You think your liver is foolish to produce cholesterol unnecessarily? No. Actually, a recent study in France showed women in the old age homes who are 90, nearing 90, 100 and all, their cholesterols are 800, 900. That's why they survived. Supposing you had lowered that. Anyway, you lower for whatever it is to see a good report and laboratories are happy, you are happy, patient is happy, everybody is happy. What do we give them? Statins, another big poison. 10% of statin takers become diabetics in 1 year. This is the biggest side effect, which means we are manufacturing 1 million diabetics in India every year. Manjula, are you happy with this much of diabetes or you want more? Now, thyroid is also like that. We don't have a definition of normal in modern medicine. We have only average. I told you it's not a science, it's a statistical science. I'll give you an example. It's very difficult to explain the whole thing. What is the normal height of Indian males? There's a study done, 1,000 Indian males studied. So they have a Gaussian curve. Naturally, there'll be short fellows, long fellows, tall fellows, short fellows, etc., etc. So there's a Gaussian curve in statistics. I can't explain that now because I don't have chalk. And there is a mean plus two standard deviation, which means, in short, Indian males, if they're between 5.4 and 5.6, they're average. But what we say, they're normal. Okay? That's what happens to sugar, blood pressure, blood sugar, everything, cholesterol, etc., blah, 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 blah. Now, imagine Amitabh Bachchan comes for a checkup. He's 6.2. What's our treatment? Cut his leg and make him 5.4. Next day, Jaya Bachchan goes for a checkup. How old is she? 4.6. So, transplant a leg for her, so she also becomes 5.2. Can you believe this? This is what is called one size fits all hypothesis in medicine. So, Manjula, all that you are talking is epidemiologists producing epidemics. In the last 100 years, there is a study done, in the last 100 years, there has not been even 1% increase in any disease. There has not been even 1% absolute increase in any disease, but there is only relative increase in diseases. Now, for example, you say a lot of people have heart disease. It's the checkup heart disease. In the olden days, if a man has chest pain, he comes to the doctor, then we make a diagnosis. Today, not like that. We have heart day running. So 100 people run, 40 people get breathlessness. They go to the hospital. We do an angiogram. And if you catch hold of children in school and do an angiogram, 76% of them have three vessel blocks. If they didn't have, they won't survive. So when we see this, it's a heart disease, a label. This is called labeling disease. So nothing has increased. Okay? Any other question? No question? Illa, hasivagtade. Eshtu gante aitu? 12:30 is right time to go to the temple. Thank you all very much. God bless you. And thank you, Manjula.
Thank you, sir, for enriching and enlightening us.
A vote of thanks ella beda. Illige mugisu aitha. Jana ganamana.
Thank you, audience, for being active participants. With this, we come to the end of today's session. Thank you.